is Frank Blair. I'm speaking to you from outer space. I'm in a studio in New York City, but the picture on this monitor is being transmitted from 3,000 miles out in space by means of a communication satellite. Fantastic as it seems, this historic achievement in the use of outer space for peaceful purposes was made possible by a tiny sphere, a model of which you see here, the United States communication satellite Telstar. Miraculous indeed, you say. Television signals travel in a straight line. To send these signals over land, you build a series of towers in sight of each other. But crossing the ocean is another matter. You'd have to build a tower of such immense height that it could be seen in a straight line from both shores. So instead of a tower hundreds of miles high, the communications satellite is placed at height to receive from one side and send to the other in direct lines of sight.
From a ground station nestled in the mountains at Andover, Maine, a signal is sent to a speeding satellite, an historic feat that could reshape man's future. That satellite, of course, is the Telstar, 170 pounds of complex electronic equipment that receives signals beamed from Earth, magnifies them 10 billion times, and rebroadcasts them back to Earth. Pictures, telephone calls, telegraph messages, and computer data all can be handled by the orbiting device. The Telstar receives its power from batteries that are recharged by the sapphire-coated solar cells, which in turn are activated by rays from the sun as it hurtles through space at a low point of 600 miles to a high of 3,500 miles.
Bell Telephone Laboratory scientists had been knee-deep in research and development on a lot of the ingredients that were to go into the bird, such as solar batteries, transistors, and traveling wave tubes. When they were needed, they were there to be used. They packed 10,000 electronic components in a 34.5-inch ball. Now an Earth station was needed. They went into a remote valley cupped in a ring of protecting hills near Andover, Maine. To protect the big horn that would go beneath it, they erected a 20-ton radome, 210 feet across, 16 stories high, the largest inflated shelter ever built. The control building went up to house the men in the consoles of Andover. On a brilliant June day, Telstar arrived at Cape Canaveral. It passed into the hands of its launchers. So Telstar moved to the gantry. Weight, 170 pounds. 8 years from concept of flying tower to trial in space. It was a million-dollar baby, and every move it made was watched by anxious guardians. At Canaveral, for the first time, the government, represented by NASA, would launch a private satellite. Launch and satellite bought and paid for by private industry. That industry was the Bell Telephone System. Launch vehicle, the Douglas Delta rocket, a 9-time winner. Everybody wanted to win this one. As the countdown plunged forward, suspense and confidence ran neck and neck. Launch time, 3:35 a.m., July the 10th.
Report payload status.
We're ready.
Launch director, we have received clear to launch.
Minus 50.
Start remote camera number one.
Started.
Close blockhouse vents.
Close. T minus 20 seconds. Mark.
Start camera and mic tape recorders.
Camera and mic tape on.
Minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5,
open solo fuel vent.
3, 2, 1, 0.
Start.
Plus 1, 3,
two,
Telstar was launched 033500 on the button.
The real test is still to come. Finding the tiny star 3,000 miles up in space, racing around the Earth at more than 16,000 miles an hour. Tracking Telstar began in the woods near Andover, Maine, remote from radio interference. Across the Atlantic, at Goonhilly Downs in England, the British joined the search for Telstar. So did the French, who built on the coast of Brittany near Pleumeur-Bodou, a tracking station that's just like the one at Andover, Maine.
Control building, the men of Andover took a deep breath, settled down at their consoles. It was just about time for the curtain to go up.
Monitor conference one.
This is the director. Let's start the system status check.
System check, formation one, starting at 22, 45, 37 UT. Command tracker report.
Command ops ready.
Precision track ready. TEG ready.
Data ops ready.
Receiver ready.
Transmitter is ready.
Across the Atlantic, in a quiet corner of Brittany, France, another great horn antenna waited. Would Telstar bridge the big pond? The newsmen of press and television were there. One thing sure, fail or succeed, the experiment was out in the open.
Starting with the sixth orbit and through the ninth, the Telstar is in range of both the US and European stations, and pictures are received clearly in France, with somewhat lesser success in Britain on this first test. The signals are beamed from this 18-story dome that houses the super-sensitive horn weighing nearly 400 tons, an antenna so delicately tuned that it picks up a mere whisper of a signal from the satellite and amplifies it again billions of times for rebroadcast over cables or the air. Now comes the historic moment. A moment compared in significance with the first message sent over the telegraph. This is the first picture transmitted to outer space and received back again on Earth. Scenes of the dome at Andover are flashed across the sea, and man marks another milestone in this age of scientific miracles. So proudly it waves.